the triple jungle ban, HOK doesn't have to do that anymore. They are fine with the Lee Sin Withers Nidalee matchup. I'm pretty sure that Jenkins, after the last game, is pretty confident on just picking like the matchup. So right now, it opens up a lot of other picks that they can just ban. Mundo, of course, Kindred ban, just leave Lee Sin and Nidalee open and get a like really good ape. Okay, Alistar.
Challenging
highest champion pool right now, which is good. I like it.
Yeah, putting that challenge out there, and of course.
Probably gonna first pick the Trundle still here. I wouldn't be too surprised if that happens. Trundle first pick.
I think first pick Elise here.
No, I wouldn't. He didn't do it last game. They didn't even first pick Elise when four jungle.
I feel like they can skip the Trundle simply because I feel like they. We haven't seen once where HUK have a clearly on paper dominant matchup in the bot lane. I feel like that's the one thing C9 has got going on for them.
But why would they ban Alistar then? It gives them the better matchup anyway, right? I mean, let him pick Alistar and take something good. Then you have to match up anyway, right?
Well, I mean, I think another point here, though, is do you think it's smart? Would you give credit to Cloud9 or maybe discredit on the fact that they banned Lucian? Are they correctly reading into H2K, I mean, seeing, well, like, okay, you guys aren't worried about the jungles, so we're going to make sure you guys can't first pick that?
Oh, Lulu was open. Never mind.
Oh, I forgot about
Okay, we have to take everything back. Lulu has to be first.
Like, Lucian, Lulu is so close.
They've made a priority of taking Lucian away from Forgiven pretty much every single time, either priority picking it, so this time I... putting it into the bans, obviously. Like, Sneaky's performed well on it, but looking some other direction. But like we said, Lulu's up. She is so powerful right now.
I'm not sure if with Thresh, like, I think I would rate Lulu a lot higher than Thresh if you have to ban a Lucian.
I don't feel like a Lucian ban is justified at this point.
No, it's not. Yeah.
It's not at all. I still think Misfortune is something that you can play into it, and it's very reliant on the support matchup. But that is where the question lies. How many supports can I play?
And so far, I mean, we've only seen the Alistar. Now is going to be the time to tell. Alistar's banned out. Thresh, Cloud9 had to ban out themselves. And Thresh is kind of usually a go-to, even if you're not that good. Everyone has played Thresh at some point if you're willing to go into a support role. So now what can High play? We'll have to wait and find out. Now the Misfortune comes out anyway, despite the Lucian ban. So clearly they were prepared to play Misfortune at some point.
I think it's really, really good because C9 has identified their weakness in the bot lane. And I think H2K, once again, are going to opt in for the Tristana to combine it with the Lulu, and then again, the weakness is covered because I still feel if H2K are put in a dominant matchup against their bot lane, I still feel they will be dominators. So I really like the C9 are kind of covering their weaknesses.
Okay, sounds fair enough.
What else is the open like? Do you have to pick jungle right now, H2K? Do you want the Lee Sin right now? Probably.
I don't think you pick Lee Sin when Elise is open. I think the matchup is way too polarizing.
I think Elise is like really good against Nidalee and both Lee Sin.
I feel like if you pick jungle at this point, it has to be the Rek'Sai.
Oh, but the Lee Sin it will be. Lee Sin,
I dislike this.
I mean, we have disliked a lot of things this tournament, but we have to agree that players are like going for comfort picks here. I would pick Elise right now. Trundle, of course, I can see why, because Trundle is... Yeah, just got handed to them. Why would you not pick it? Really good pick. Counters Misfortune. I think that's picking early Misfortune will get punished by the Trundle pick here really hard in this game, simply because of the pillar mechanic. Misfortune has no escape, and her ultimate gets interrupted instantly by the pillar.
That is also like the beauty of the fact that C9 are banning Thresh, because Thresh is considered to be the best pick into Trundle because you can kind of save people and you can also harass them very efficiently and punish the Trundle in lane.
Okay, well, Cloud9, I mean, overall, just I think the conclusion is now H2K having that win in the second game, they've kind of regained their confidence. Cloud9 is kind of put into a corner here when it comes to strategy overall. It's not just individual picks, not necessarily High, but Janna. Okay.
Taking another range support to try to punish the Trundle a little bit. Janna will also bring great siege potential when she's past level 9, has all 5 points in the shield, so she compensates for Misfortune's maybe lackluster siege comparative to other 80 carries.
Fair enough.
Of course, Lux in the Shen in the top lane, which means HOK can do what they want and can put something into the Shen matchup right now. Maybe even pick Malphite, still open.
I think Malphite is going to be very important because what C9 has
It's
like what C9 has on the table now, it's kind of lining up to a good composition. I feel like if Malphite is not going to be picked, there is going to be a massive hole.
But the biggest problem here is you have a low threat comp then. You have like low damage. Lulu and Malphite together, you need something that does a lot of damage. Like, I'm not sure if Triss is enough.
Actually, actually, though, just because the games are ending so quickly, like, I completely agree in kind of the old school meta, but because the games are ending so quickly, Lulu and Malphite are still very relevant when these inhibitors are going down. You know, if the average inhib drops at 17 minutes, you know, Lulu's only level 13, she's still hitting like a truck. It's only at that 45 minute that Lulu's like, ah, you know, my utility kind of took over for my damage.
But we have a, I mean, I can see why Rumble might be really good, especially in combination with Trundle. Think about like the Pillar and Rumble combination. Misfortune is, without Flash, Misfortune will die instantly. Like, there's nothing she can do. But the last pick, Anivia, we see it. Anivia has been a decent pick into Lulurite because just how punishing it can be. And yeah, overall.
So like this time, I have to give credit to C9 because this is the one game I feel like their win condition is way more clearer than H2K. I feel like they have this very strong team fight composition, but how are they eventually going to finish a game against a composition like this? They have the poke, and on the other side, we lack engage. So with that in mind, it's very, very interesting both sides.
Also, there's not like a clear split push answer to Shen. Mm-hmm. I don't think Rumble is, like, they have to, it's on H2K right now to win the mid game right now, and overall, we will have to see how it works out.
All right. Well, our experts saying that possibly Cloud9 having the best shot they have in ending this game with fashion. We'll have to find out in game number 3. Tied 1-1 between C9 and HK. Who will we see tomorrow going up against Ever? We'll find out right after this.
Welcome back, everybody, once again to IEM Cologne. And there is a massive third game on the line here. It has been a battle of wits and a battle across the lanes between H2K and Cloud9 and Papa Smithy.
And fittingly, we have a really balanced draft between both these teams. It's not like game one, where we're like, okay, a lot of melee champions coming in here. It's not like game two, where it felt like it was skirmish against initiation. This time, we don't really have primary initiation on either side. Only thing I can say, though, a lot of immobile champions in Cloud9. We're talking about Anivia and Misfortune, positioning-based champions. If Jankos can turn around this matchup, once again we're seeing the Lee Sin versus Nidalee. Jankos is the one who can really force the misposition out of either Anivia or Misfortune and really turn the tide of a team fight.
Oh yeah, he's got so much experience on this Lee Sin. And not only that, H2K have built themselves a classic team fighting composition. A lot of it is going to be on Forgiven to output the constant damage, but he's no stranger to that duty. And I feel like if they can get a fight in the right place, a well-placed equalizer, something Oduwamne is very known for, can spell the end for Cloud9 here.
We finally see the Misfortune come out in this particular series, and it's with Trundle available. And the reason why Trundle's seen as a pseudo-counter to the Misfortune is that you have a massive cast range on the Pillar of Ice, and the Pillar of Ice, and everyone knows this, is actually an interrupt. It does have that mini displacement effect, so it stops the channel from the bullet time. Is Rush going for the same ward invaders did previously? Gonna be spotted, but not really a lot of counterplay available for a Trundle in that situation.
Yeah, well, now that Forgiven has gone just outside of the ward range, well, of course, it's not gonna spot through the wall, he can back and decide to move it back towards the top side. But the question is, does he want to do that? This bottom lane that Cloud9 is running is gonna be a lot of kite, and I feel like he might want to take the 2v1.
Of information available to Cloud9. They're the ones that were able to get the aggressive wards on both sides of the enemy jungle. Maybe that's one of the reasons we're seeing the priority on a champion like Nidalee, is that she is unique in being able to balance aggressive and defensive vision just because she has those wall jumps.
Very true, and it's clearly a comfortable pickup for Rush, but you know, Jankos on this Lee Sin has made it last a lot longer. We had a very long game by comparison, 38 minutes that last time around. But H2K definitely seemed way more in control of it once they started to turn it around on the Baron. I feel like Cloud9, though, will not make that same kind of mistake twice.
Jankos is just, as I said, the Lee Sin. He's the one with the options in the team fight. Can you get behind that Anivia? Can you get behind that Misfortune? Kick one of those into your teammates, take them down, and it looks like a one-team fight for H2K as Vander face checks a lot of damage.
Sometimes you just gotta troll, but he joins up with Forgiven in the top side, and we have a 2v2. Sneaking high guest ride, if that's indeed what they wanted to take. A lot of speed boosts here. As long as he's moving towards that Janna, Sneaky will be able to strut it out quite fast.
And look, the Janna coming out, that was the question. We're like, okay, after the Alistar, what's he got? And the answer's Janna, you know, a champion who hasn't really been talked about in the same breadth as champion like Bard and the other champions who are really talked about. Definitely not one of the strongest abusers of a really powerful item like Phosphorine's Claim. Of course, it's fine on the Janna, but not quite the same abuser when it comes, say, Bard, for example, who can get those Thunderlords procs instantly and win trades at level 1. The Janna, with such a strong lane like Misfortune, is still going to be absolutely fine. The 2v2 is Rush.
Looks to rush down Odawamne, gets the taunt, but Rush does not synchronize with the spear. Instantly flashed away by Odawamne. They do get the summoner, but Balls takes a whole lot of damage from the Flamespitter.
That's not what we were expecting.
No,
it's actually Cloud9 that have the communication breakdown. You can see they weren't on the same wavelength. The result is they expend the flash for no result. Rush used that, speared into where he expected the opponent to be, not accounting for the taunt flash from Balls.
You know, we thought this mid lane was going to be much more of a farm fest, but these two guys really have it out for each other. You know, a disengaging champion like Lulu, Ryu tries to push forward, but he gets punished by Jensen after the stun lands.
I mean, Jensen's the one that has to be creative in this matchup, of course, doesn't have the reliable wave clear that we associate with Anivia until level 6, whereas Ryu can just throw out the glitter lands, push aplenty, and he's the one's going to push in this Anivia until level 6 is achieved.
Yeah. Cloud9 repping the North American pride here with that Anivia skin as well. Rush should be able to focus with Impunity on this topside if he really wants to try and push it forward, but of course he's going to wait until Forgiven and Vander have pushed out. Remember, Forgiven has had a number of positional errors this game. He usually comes up with a kill or at least trades even, but when he does jump forward into an unexpected amount of enemy team members, he gets shut down pretty easily.
Yeah, the over-aggression that we don't usually associate with Forgiven, specifically in competitive, has come to the kind of solo queue-esque players where you're like, oh, I'm going to go Guts or Glory. And of course, they just fall flat on the face. But we're not going to expect too much more of that. It's his first series in a long time after his competitive ruling on a new team. Game 2 was much more solid display coming through from Forgiven, and we expect that to continue. Same champion, 3 games in a row.
Yeah, well, you know, when Illusion is taken away from him, lately he has been liking this Tristana a lot more. He did pick it up last season after people started, you know, shutting down his Graves when it was still really in vogue, shutting his Caitlyn down. And of course, you know, we saw people spending 2-3 bans on this guy constantly, and with good reason. Question is, will he be able to put out the damage in teamfights that HQ needs? Because this is the kind of comp they built around it. It's him and Odawamne.
I mean, you get to that tipping point where you have the Whimsy coming through from Ryu. Let's return to the Lulu. It's been permabanned a lot. You know, Lulu, of course, was in vogue for almost the majority of the 2015 series. Consider this. We're in this preseason patch where games are ending much earlier. You have to remember that the result there is that there never comes that point where Lulu is considered only a utility bot, only an ult bot, only a Whimsy bot. You are going to do respectable damage as Lulu at 27 minutes, and games are frequently ending way before the 30-minute mark. So Lulu, whether it's Deathcap, whether it's Luden's Echo after that inevitable first mana regen item, is going to be doing respectable damage for the majority of a preseason game.
And you can talk about the same thing with this Nidalee pick as well. So even though we didn't really anticipate it to be as popular as it has been today, it really does seem to do a lot in the right hands. If Rush can continue to prove true to his name and keep the pressure on H2K, it could definitely prove to be a solid pick here. Yankos will manage to land. His Q goes in, follows up. It's a little bit of extra damage out, and Ryu tries to chase forward, but he really doesn't need any help here. A great trade for Yankos to start this one off, although Ryu's a little bit zoned out thanks to the Anivia ult.
And Yankos is just reacting to the fact that Anivia, what can she do? She can wave clear very well, but she's anchored to the mid lane. This is a champion with the lowest base movement speed in the game. Whimsy means that Ryu will always be the first to react to any sort of jungle skirmish, and therefore Yankos, this game, he's finally on the front foot after having watched Rush basically dictate the previous game.
They keep fighting over that Raptor, man. Scraps all over that jungle. Jensen will spend his teleport getting back to lane. Remember, we talked about the double teleport being available for both these teams. These fights can get absolutely hectic the longer the game goes on, and the timing is very important. Obviously, 6 minutes into the game, it's not as important. Jensen getting back to lane is definitely going to be useful as we see a little bit of a trade in the top lane. Hai manages to push Forgiven and Vander back as Sneaky will finish off clearing that wave, but this is a lane that, if they manage to get caught, they don't have too many tools to disengage outside of the Janna ulti, which isn't quite available yet.
Oh, come on. Janna's the queen of disengage pyrotechnics. So.
Well, she's got the knockup, but you have to be able to land it in a line to get both these guys off. However, there's a really good trade with the double up. Sneaky's been able to do a lot of damage on Forgiven here, but he's low on mana, so they have to be careful.
I haven't spied whether he's maxing E like we saw both Bebe and Uzi doing at All-Star, if he's going for the more traditional Q match, max. I think Thunderlords, of course, hasn't been reduced to 20-second cooldown, so still very powerful, but not quite the power of the 524, where we will see the League of Thunderlords in full effect. Still very powerful. The fact that you can trade from so far away, Make It Rain is unique in that every proc of the ability counts as a separate cast, so therefore a Thunderlord's proc is inevitable, given that you can cast it from so far, and there's nothing an AD carry can do. You just basically, whenever they start attacking minions, throw out that Make It Rain, you'll get the Thunderlord's proc, and you'll win the trade just because it's out of damage return range for basically every enemy AD carry.
And it's especially true against the Tristana as well. And when it comes to those team fights, you know, it's going to come down to how well Balls and Sneaky can synergize their own abilities. Because if you land a Shenton on multiple targets and then just unleash Bullet Time, it's going to be so hard for HTK to fight back through all of that. But they have a lot of tools of their own. If Odawamne comes around the side and, you know, nails the Equalizer, that then turns the tables for HTK.
I mean, space control, that's what the Equalizer provides. So theoretically, you can't channel that ultimate and just sit on top of the Equalizer. So where will there be a fight where Vanda has already used Spilla, thus doesn't have it available to interrupt Bullet Time, and Odawamne is already ulted? That's the only team fight where realistically Sneaky will be able to channel Bullet Time. It has such high potential damage. 5,000 damage with 3 or 4 AD items is what's potential out of Misfortune, but these pocket picks, this new pick and Trundle support, is one of the best at shutting down what Bullet Time's all about.
And certainly make the interrupt happen. Rush trying to control this top side. A little bit of pressure to clear out the crab. It gets the vision. They've got a couple of pink wards invested all through that river, so they will spot anybody that goes through it, as well as a deep ward over by the Gromp to spot Yankos when he comes around. And it really has been a lot of attention paid to in this top side, but so far, Sneaky's winning it, and that's really to be expected in this MF versus Tristana matchup, to tell you the truth.
It's weird to say, but you'd have to say that Janna has slightly more lane presence than Trundle. You know, usually yeah. She's the one that has to be on the back foot, but Misfortune, she's a lane-dominant champion. You throw the shield on, and Sneaky's basically 1v2ing, but that one of those two is Trundle, who, you know, all about the pillar, all about the utility, yeah. Not so much about the laning.
Well, there's the pillar there, but look at that Make It Rain. That's going to be immediately Sneaky packing away as soon as he sees a sight of Yankos, but nearly picked off Forgiven before it happened.
Yes, Forgiven was smart. They knew he couldn't be greedy enough to just use the rocket jump. He needs to flash instantly, because would have died to the procs of the Bullet Time during the channel of the rocket jump, so Jankos has to stay on top to try and relieve pressure. C9, they're going to extend their advantage in the top lane.
Yeah, they keep it up. I mean, the gold's pretty even in this one since we really haven't seen much outside of the lanes. We're almost on the 10-minute mark without the first blood, but this game has been so much more about careful planning and execution than insane fighting as Jensen finds Ryu and forces out the Wild Growth.
Wild Growth used, no other summoners though, and still has that teleport. Ryu hasn't been to back for a long time. Was able to just whimsy back to lane rather than Jensen, who was forced to teleport back into lane. Vanna doesn't back. He's just there to stop the turret from falling down. And yeah, no kills. 10 minutes in. Definitely not a Chinese League of Legends game right here.
No, this is a lot more LCK for sure. Ryu goes ahead and picks himself up his blue buff. Jensen will take the moment he's gone to clear away a ward in the brush. And Ryu's got to be careful here. Jensen has just enough mana to be able to do that.
Ooh.
Not quite enough on the wrong side of the wall, but he still made him think twice about it. And he is running this lane right now with a slight CS advantage.
To worry though, used his flash aggressively, couldn't quite get the pick, and now suddenly, Jankos, he's gonna have wards, he's gonna have ward jumps. Suddenly, Anivia is looking like a potential gank recipient in the mid lane. As Rush continues to be the annoying Nidalee that we know him to be.
I was gonna say, it's really, really a big nuisance in Jankos' side, but he's been, you know, giving as good as he's getting this series so far. In the last game, they got, of course, the same picks. Rush will help out Jensen to clear the wave, who's gonna need to back away as he's completely run out of mana at this point. And we'll see the duo lane swap a little bit back to the bottom side on both sides.
Yeah, that happens a lot later in this patch just because Dragon doesn't have that same priority. Of course, the problem with going for that lane swap is you usually gave up an early Dragon or the early Dragon snowball to a team, but just not a factor so much in the preseason patch. That might change in future patches, but at least on 5.23, Dragon's deprioritization leads to, what, 20-minute first Dragons, if that?
Yeah, and there's just no reason to take it early. I mean, yes, you get a small boost, but you're not going to try to fight early on. What do you give up in exchange? You might lose a tower or two. Most teams are willing to take that, and that's why we're seeing it be deprioritized at the moment. Odawamne is going to go back down to the bottom side. It looks like Forgiven and Vander just do not want this 2v2.
And in general, this just shows you that on patch 5.23, you're happy to trade guaranteed farm on Forgiven, you know, in this matchup of Tristana versus Shen over going for that Dragon. That's how much Dragon's deprioritized. Oh. Oh, here we go.
Fantastic Equalizer forcing Sneaky to flash. Hai will throw down his own Monsoon. Meanwhile, though, Rush is getting kicked through the Dragon Pit, and Jankos connects for first blood on H2K's side. Out jungled.
Yes, solo kill between the junglers. Solo kill in the skill matchup. It was all about Rush previous game. This time, Jankos, from early on when we saw we had the pressure advantage with Ryu being able to rotate. This time, it's just a pure 1v1.
able to pick himself up a little bit of gold. This also alleviates some pressure as Ryu pushes in on the mid. Vander and Oduwamne push in on the bottom. Forgiven pushes in on the top.
And they get everything. They get the turret damage down on bot. They get the solo farm on Forgiven, who is struggling in the 2v2. We're going to watch a replay. We're going to get the actual full video between these two. This was Jankos going in aggressive, missing the first Q.
Just has so much more damage here. Even with the Gromp buff, instant kick, manages to nearly clip the Nidalee.
And we're always fast and ready to praise Rosh's mechanics. Jankos is on point.
Yeah, I mean, this is why it's such a comfortable champion for him. And solid Lee Sin players will always find a place in the meta, no matter what it is. And Vander is one of the best, if not the best, jungler in Europe.
Lee Sin's a champion that survives all metas. Now, even against Kindred, has options. Sneaky's caught.
Yeah, and is just caught between a cone and an Oduwamne. Not to mention Vander for good measure, but in comes Balls to try and save the day. Taunt is on, Rush is coming around. There's the bullet time. Vander has nearly no health, and he's taken out by a Vorpal Blade from Balls. Oduwamne caught now with the rest of Cloud9. A very quick collapse, and H2K don't know what hit him.
But why are H2K making these aggressive moves with no AD carry in the bot lane? They just ran out of damage. They had Misfortune dead to rights, didn't have Flash, still had heal up.
Rush nearly ate it there.
Picks were still on him, but didn't have the cooldown. Of course, hasn't gone for any CDR in this build, gone for the Rod of Ages. It didn't have the second rotation of spells coming through. H2K had made the conceded choice to go for farm on Tristana. They don't worry about giving up dragons. They actually got more than they expected and got the turret in bottom, but they got too greedy looking for kills, ran out of damage, and now undo some of their really good early work in the first 15 minutes.
Yeah, a little bit of back and forth there, but all said and done, we have 1,000 gold advantage still in favor of H2K despite the kill deficit. And that's really all in those two towers that they managed to get. One in the bottom, Forgiven finished off the one in the top, but it was at, you know, cost of two kills over to Cloud9.
And the turret change is something that kind of been slept on. Not, of course, the turret health changes. You know, it's very well known now that inner turrets are kind of like paper compared to where they were before. Just much lower effective health until much later in the game. But the other change was, if you thought about Riot's trend, it was towards deprioritizing global gold from turrets. Now, the global gold's very much there. One of the biggest ways to secure gold onto these low-income members is to pick up the global gold coming through from taking down turrets. So whenever you get them down, it's the support, it's the lower income members that massively are benefited from picking up those turrets.
Yeah. And on top of that, Hai is going to have himself even more gold once he finishes off the Frostbane's claim. But he's, of course, opted to be a little bit more vision-oriented early on, finishes his Sightstone early, gets his cooldown boots. H2K will go ahead and start off this dragon. I still feel it's a bit risky if Cloud9 knew about it, but they're not going for it.
I mean, to be fair, H2K actually have pretty good vision around the Rift Herald, not exactly on top of it, but they knew they weren't trading it for any other objectives. They didn't lose anything barring some minion control for picking up that first dragon. And once you have that one in the bank, it's all about denying the first dragon from the enemy or just accepting that it's an equal trade of stats.
Yeah. Well, this is all coming down to the deep vision that they did have placed, so they knew Rush might have been in the area, but he wasn't moving towards them.
To say there's a vision disparity would be an understatement. H2K have a wonderful array of aggressive wards and only really defensive vision coming through from Cloud9. They do not have any vision ahead of the middle of the map, barring one ward around the blue of H2K.
And, you know, that's the advantage of the double sidestone, too. Jankos still favors this build, and you can see why. It's helping them out quite a lot here. Of course, you know, League of Blue Trinkets means you can pretty much place things down relatively all over the place, but those wards evaporate pretty easily as soon as somebody steps on them. Speaking of, Rush will go ahead and find himself a pink. But H2K are doing really good work with this vision that they have gained, and as long as they don't get caught and cocky, Cloud9 are going to have a hard time taking them down.
And that's why the fact that in a meta where you have blue trinkets, which means you have non-committal vision, you can put down vision far away without having to face check anything, the fact that they have four blue trinkets and yet still haven't got any advanced vision across the river lets you know that Cloud9 are in turtle mode. They have no interest of contesting anything on the enemy side. They've basically ceded the enemy side of the jungle and are only really looking to try and fight for what should rightfully be theirs.
Yeah, we saw this early on in the first game, but of course Cloud9 did manage to turn that one around. Ryu is caught now, and a lot more damage will force out the ultimate from him, but Jankos and Vander are here to the rescue. Jensen very quickly flashes away from the pillar.
and needed his flash up. I believe it just had come back up. We were reflecting on the fact that it was down just a few minutes ago. There's a Shen ultimate.
Yeah, Rush is looking to come in. Nice Electro Harpoon to slow him down. Balls will still manage to land the taunt. And now, in 2v1 mode, Odawamne is overheating and out of time. Throws down the equalizer. The minions will slow up Rush for only a second. Pounces on him and grabs himself his second kill of the game.
Odawamne was silenced for the most. He threw down the ult just to try and counter push, and he missed the minion wave. So that was definitely sad times for Odawamne.
0-2, not the greatest start for him right now. However, it is going to be all about those team fights for H2K. Gold is still relatively even, but that could change on a dime. Although Sneaky is pushing a tower in the bottom side, H2K have brought a few more friends to the party in the mid. Ignoring Jensen for a moment, Jankos actually gets pushed out for just a second, and the spear nearly connects on him. He's got to be careful. He could get taken down quick. The Janna shield almost saves the day, but it's going to be Forgiven getting taunted up by Balls. Vander now is the target that they look for. Jankos kicks in Rush, but he doesn't connect the Sonic Wave. Instantly, they turn back on him. Balls is still causing havoc in the back line, but Odawamne is here to the rescue, and he's burning away the members of Cloud9. Vander stays alive. Rush has got to back out, but Forgiven's right on his tail.
You can see the bullet time's channel. That's finally going to be Rush falling down. It's a 2-for-1 trade, a minimal trade. H2K went for the engage, but there were so many mini stuns on Jankos that despite the fact he got the war job into the back, he couldn't get that early initiation. Would have been much more of a landslide win for H2K, but still looked pretty damn good.
3-to-1, they're going to grab themselves another turret. It may not have been the team fight that they wanted, but it was the one they needed right now. The skirmish that they could follow up with adding more members to the party, and just keeping Forgiven safe, letting him pump out the damage, letting Odawamne get in the front line and just chase everyone away. It worked perfectly.
It's all about the Lulu, Pyra. This is a champion that should be contested for first pick or ban in every game at the strength and the pace of the current patch. The damage doesn't fall off because the game doesn't go far enough for it to do so. And the utility on the AD carries, who had this new suite of beautiful weapons to be able to do more damage. The two-item power spikes are real for the AD carries. And at that same time, the Whimsy's speeding them up. And the fights just go in the advantage of the Lulu team far more often than not.
Yeah, and when combined with this Tristana too, I mean, when your job as an AD carry is to sit as far back as you can and pump out constant damage uninterrupted, Tristana fits that bill well. But combined with a rapid fire cannon, you get even more range adding to your passive. You can continue to just pump away and hopefully grab some crits. You can wreck towers as soon as the fights are over. It's kind of the complete package, and I feel like this is why Forgiven favors it so much when his Lucian's taken out of the pool.
Yeah, the pushing power. That's the reliable thing that no one can outpush at Tristana, not with the changes for Jinx a few patches ago. So, yeah, Cloud9 on the back foot, still not with any sort of aggressive vision. H2K sniffing around for a gank up top, not going to find anything. But it's the reality of Anivia. You have equal wave clear at this point between Lulu and Anivia, but Anivia can't react fast to anything. Nothing about her is speedy in that way, and Whimsy makes everyone a potential pick champion for H2K.
Vander is going to get caught up, but he will send his cone out to stop any further damage from coming. And for Cloud9, yeah, this Anivia, it's tough to pull off because you need to be able to catch people. And what CC do they have on their side? Other than Anivia's own, you're going to have pretty much Balls.
Yep.
Unless you can land like a flash Janna Monsoon.
Engage has not been their thing. That's why I said neither of these teams have true engage. Jankos is the one who has the options, has the suite of CC. But of course, you have to be pretty optimistic to pick up the inset kicks that are required to get engaged. So the Whimsy's the big change.
Yeah.
The fact that you're going to have positioning at every opportunity is, here we go.
Rush jumps in, and he's going to get some help from Balls in just a minute. There comes Jankos, kicks Balls back away. They land an equalizer, and Jankos will pick up a kill on Rush. Balls still burning away as Odawamne turns to try and head off the rest of Cloud9. Balls will fall, but not before Sneaky bullet times his way to half-health Vander. Odawamne, exhausted, has to turn away. High is going to disengage with a Monsoon. Odo flashes the wall, but the rest of Cloud9 have already gotten the hell out of Dodge.
And HK is able to move back. They get the one kill. They're going to push up the lanes. Every lane consistently pushed. Full channel of bullet time. Gets a lot of damage onto Vander, but only Vander. And that's the crucial factor, is that no one is tunneling into the bullet time from H2K.
Yeah, and if anybody can tank it up for a little while, it's Vander. As Jankos looks to start off the dragon, he might even be able to do this one solo, but it's going to be slow. So we'll call over the help of Forgiven. This one should be pretty easy for them to take, although it's spotted out by Cloud9. They know that if they... Well, they won't be able to collapse on it, but they can safely push out of the lanes without having to worry about getting caught for the moment.
Take down that second dragon. Not a massive factor to comment on. High is pretty far caught out. Does he have flash available? Well, he does. Will he have to use it? Answer is no.
He's able to save himself a lot of pain by throwing down the shield. Odo is blocked off by the Anivia wall. Jensen will clear out the wave and keep on backing away. A very safe pick in this Anivia just because he hasn't been caught in the back, but he remains at 0-0-1 because he can't in turn pump out the damage on the targets in the back line of H2K.
Had a bit of an impasse at this moment. There doesn't seem to be anything that can really swing the game. The lack of engage is what means that we're going to see a lot of minion wave pushing. We're waiting for a titanic fight over the likes of Baron just because Dragon is no longer a point of contest. So feels like when you're forced to fight, because remember, neither of these teams have the true engage options. The only way to force a fight used to be the threat of, say, fourth or fifth Dragon. Well, not really a factor anymore. I guess it might be with such low engage in this particular game. But Baron is probably the only guaranteed place that you'll get a big fight between two low engage comps.
The difference between these two teams, though, is Cloud9 definitely doesn't want to take that if they can avoid it. They want to be able to 0 to 100 a few people. But HGK are the ones that really have the ability to team fight once it comes down to bashing heads. They're going to keep Odoamne top for the meantime to deal with the wave, but there's four Cloud9 members in this middle. They've got to be careful, though, because Forgiven is pushing balls back towards this turret. They could turn around and collapse on him, but that'll be an instant whistle from H2K as Odo now comes down to try and even the odds in this mid.
And it'll be a super predictable collapse. Look at the defensive wards. It's littered with wards, and that's why they're trying to counter-push their own, but Jankos
doesn't quite get the insect the direction he wanted, but Sneaky now is going to be burning down, even with the help of the Monsoon. Jankos occupying Jensen in Rush. He manages to egg the Nivea, and now Rush trying to throw the spears out. There's the wild growth on, but it won't even matter.
And Shaitan's going in.
Yeah, Forgiven should be able to polish off high. Almost gets Rush, but the flash is there. He has the reset, however. Manages to get a bit more damage, and he's on the chase. The rest of H2K at his back. Rush should be able to escape, but it may be a wild ride throughout his own jungle.
Look, it's a return to what H2K tried to do in game one, but with such superior defensive warding. It's in a great spot.
Flashing in, manages to take him out. Ryu will get the kill there, and instantly the Baron is started. Nothing Cloud9 can do. They're all dead, except for balls.
This is looking like a massive upset, Pyro. We're looking like the two-day-old lineup of H2K might be able to take down the much-vaunted lineup from Cloud9 that have practiced for a month. Remember, they denied High from going to All-Star, saying, no, we want to scrim. We are looking to win IEM Cologne. And 24 minutes into game three, it's looking like a bit of a dream at this point.
Might be in the pipe as well. H2K, you know, they're looking together in these 5v5s, and that's the crazy thing, that they've only had a couple days together. Now, it's not completely true that they've, you know, none of them have any experience working together, sure, since we have, you know, Vander and Jankos coming over from Rocket. We have Odo and Ryu sticking around. But Forgiven, you know, this guy's coming in from after having not played a few months. He's done his job to a T as Tristana. He clearly knows his champion. He knows exactly the positioning he needs to be in. Yes, he's made some aggressive plays this series that have turned the tide in favor of Cloud9.
But let's be fair.
But this time it's great.
H2K are playing themselves into form. They had a great first 15 to 20 minutes in game one, and then predictably, they overpushed. They overstayed. They didn't have the defensive wards. They went down. You have to praise what Proly's been able to do in between games here, because the improvement in game one to three, this is what, let's say realistically, maybe the 15th or 16th game these teams have played, you are seeing significant game-on-game improvement from H2K.
The turnaround's definitely been fantastic for them, and everyone's getting up to speed on this lineup right now. This is the scary thing for Cloud9, and despite the gold differential being just so massive, you can see what's really coming into play here. Huge item advantage for Odoamne. Forgiven has done exactly what he needed to do, and he just has a whole boatload of crit. The Lulu is still relevant. As you said, it doesn't really matter because the games don't go 40-plus minutes anymore. The Lulu still is incredibly effective. Odoamne could get chased down here.
Oh, boy. 4 seconds slow.
But he dodges the spear.
Not looking to engage. Forgiven is happy to take a couple of turret shots because guaranteed damage coming on to this top turret. Split push Forgiven has been the story multiple times. That's how he uses the Tristana. It's not about the 5-5 team fights. Yeah. It's taking out every structure he can find.
Slow methodical push in here for H2K. Balls can't get in there to defend, and Ryu will polish off the turret. Balls could be in trouble. Another one falls in the middle as the Tristana has rejoined. There's two open inhibs, and Sneaky is nearly taken out. Equalizer thrown down. Jankos kicks High back in. Forgiven's knocked away, but he's got a wild growth on him. High will melt, and so will Jensen. Now it's going to be big trouble for Cloud9. They've lost two members, and an inhibitor's going down with the Baron buff pushing in. This could be the end of the game here, Papa Smithy.
The full court press from H2K with this Lulu has been exactly what I expect from this champion, patch 523. Gonna see a bit more fighting, but with the next exposed, H2K pull out the upset. 2 days into this lineup, they have upset Cloud9.
Big win for them on the board. Questions abounded after that first game. But all smiles now for the H2K lineup, a brand new squad of guys, and this truly looks like the European super team.
It's starting to play as strong as the lineup on paper suggested they had the potential to. We've heard Proly pre-game talk about the fact that it wasn't the same well-rounded team, that it had its peaks and troughs, but they looked like they were on the same point just three games into a series at their first event 2 days after getting the lineup together.
After a rough start for them, they really impaled Cloud9 on those sharp spikes they've got. I really like this. There's so many wild cards that they can pull out. You know, we saw Ryu step up and carry in game two on the LeBlanc. We saw him really be a bully on the Lulu as well. Forgiven did his job exactly what he needed to. He didn't need to play anything but Tristana, but it's good to know that he's got several things in his pocket at this point.
And it kind of puts into light Forgiven's career. You look back on SK, very common to have 380 carry bans against him. That team was all about Forgiven. That was their one trick. And once it was found out, that team started to fall apart. On Gambit, he tried to play a different role. You mentioned it, more of a team role. Didn't quite have the cavalry with him to really make it work. And now, still playing the team role on this third team, but what a team he has around him and the difference shown in that victory.
I feel like, you know, everyone's really shown a lot of positives on both these teams, but especially this series. Jankos has impressed me so much. He had a bit of a trough during the last season, even when he was on signature champions like Lee Sin. And I feel like he might have just have not been playing up to the level. Maybe they just were afraid of falling down in the rankings. But Jankos has shown up massive this time around. And, you know, you got to start thinking about that Lee Sin as a target ban going forward in these next couple matches.
And we saw Rush's Nidalee versus Jankos' Lee Sin two games in a row. And fittingly, Rush well on top in the first game. Jankos, he made it look good in game two. And if we take one thing away from this particular game, that third game of the series, no more Lulu, please, because that champion just ran over Cloud9 and ensured that another short game just because takes over the game, the damage is still relevant. And even without true engage, if you're moving at 900 miles an hour, anyone can be a pick champion.
It's absolutely true. Now, we're going to go ahead and send it down stage side where we're ready for the post-game interview from H2K's jungler.
It's fine, dude.
Hey, guys, here we are back. I'm joined by Jankos.
Hello.
First off, Jankos, congratulations. Let's shake it out.
There you go.
Very well done.
Thank you.
The old mic swap. Let's start in there. Obviously, map one didn't go your favor. Map two, it seemed like the choice of LeBlanc going up against the blind choice of Cassiopeia really changed things for you. How did you see that?
Well, we knew we need to have like mobile mid laner and as well a little bit of burst if we had like such a sustained damage team comp. So we just went for LeBlanc and as well like LeBlanc and Lee Sin, I'm pretty sure can win like easily versus Cassiopeia and Nidalee mid lane. So like we also wanted to go for the 2v2 mid. And Ryu is like got LeBlanc, you know, so it was perfect pick for him and he wanted to play it, so why not, you know?
Now, from that moment, game two onwards, you kind of seem to start playing more cohesively as a team. You started to work better, both also in the decision making. What changed for you and your teammates?
I think the issue is that we had only 2 days of practice with like our coach and like total of 4 days without, which means like 2 days like of solo queue screams, you know? So like the issue for us is that we still are not good as a team. So in first game, when we had like 2-3k gold lead, I believe, and they had like better scaling team comp with like Mundo, for example, in the jungle, like we had the lead and then like we didn't snowball and like we went for the crazy 1v1 fights, like for example, Tristana bot died and then like Fiora on enemy blue buff. It was like so random. So like in second game, we spoke with the Proly, with our coach, and he said that like we kind of need to stop doing that and we need to play as a team, you know, like we had good seed, just like group up, you know, play as a team when you are ahead. And like that went pretty easy, I guess, you know.
It seems like it worked out. Now,
and then like, wait.
Sorry, I apologize. No,
and then
go.
Like, I'm pretty sure like, I think Shen Sunfire like stole the Nashor like after my smite. So I think that was like super big in this game because if they would get the Nash, they'd probably like end the game like or snowball more. But like because we got the Nash, it was, yeah, it kind of saved us, to be fair.
Okay. So now looking at that matchup, you guys went up against Rush and this is a great Lee Sin and Nidalee player. Was that something that you had kind of, you seemed comfortable with that? Was that something that you had prepared for, practiced for, just confidence? What was going on there?
I mean, like, so basically, I played against like the best EU junglers, which is like amazing, and like Svenskeren and Shook. Like, those people are like so good, you know? So, like Isra's like even better than them. Like, maybe a little bit because he's like Korean guy, so he's like God, you know? But like, I don't think he's that, like, you can't just rate him like super high, you know? He's like just normal player, and you play as a team, and you don't care about this. So, overall, I rate my performance like not as good as his. I think he played better at least like first and second game. I would say I played better on the third game. And it was mainly because first game, he outscaled me, so he did like more damage and stuff like with Mundo, but like I had way better early game. And then second game, I died like way too many times on Lee Sin because I was trying to save my team. But like third game, I killed him like 1v1 because Lee Sin like can actually do that with Red Smite. Like he can actually outplay Nidalee. So I was pretty happy with that. Like he was good. He was very good. I've heard as well from Sven Skeren that he's like the best NA jungler or like second best, you know, that I should be careful for him. So yeah, it went fine, you know, I think.
It did go very fine because you have secured yourself a place in day two. So what will you and the guys do tonight? What goes on from here on out?
I mean, we just probably like go back to the hotel, eat something, and we will talk about tomorrow's game. The issue is that we'll play Korean team, and like Koreans, well, we all know like they are better than the other ones, but we will see. Like we are not scared. The only issue, like I said, we didn't practice as much, but we'll do our best.
Well, you've done very well so far, and the fans have been super supportive of you. Anything you'd like to say to the fans?
Yeah, I mean, I think, like, the real tournament starts tomorrow because, like, all the NA teams are out. So, like, now it's going to be competitive.
Well, thank you so much for taking the time to talk to me. Sure, lots to break down, so we'll head back over to the one and only Cerber Commander.